Episode 3093, How Do You Nurture Hope in Marriage?
Moms, it's time to rediscover, rejuvenate, and renew who you are in mind, body, and spirit. Welcome to Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie, the show to help you do just that. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo.
Staring at a stop sign, watching people drive by.
Happy, happy day. Are you ready for a front seat view? Oh, yes. I think you need to be tired of sitting in the back row. I think you need to move up to the front, and you need to be engaged in your marriage. How do you nurture hope in marriage? For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, welcome to this incredible family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already haven't had the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple strategy, everyday solutions to live, love, and impact. Well, this episode is brought to you by AIM, inspiring connection and community. How do you nurture hope in marriage? You only succeed to the proportion you work at it. So despite whose fault is what, you can still impact and preserve the flickering flames of hope. You know, navigating a marriage where one spouse seems less invested can be disheartening, right? It's a challenge, but it's important to know that you as an individual can still make an impact. Now, I must say that when you're in the thick of it, everything seems impossible. But as you know, nothing is impossible with God. And if you are willing and ready to take aim, God will work on your spouse while you work on yourself. You see, that's really the heart of the problem here. Most people blame their spouses for the troubles in their marriage. Yet just as it takes two to tango, it takes two to get you where you are, good, bad, or ugly. I mean, you could literally ask all the counselors that are out there, all the pastors that are out there, all the therapists, the stats show that if you are in a position to make a change, you can still impact that change of where you are. However, most people don't seek help until it's too late. So if you're in a position right now that says, you know what, I know something's not right in our marriage, we need to do something differently, and you genuinely want to nurture hope in your marriage, you have to be willing to look in the mirror. Because if not, you might as well turn off this episode and stop listening to me. I mean, I'm being honest with you. You need to do your part in order to nurture hope in your marriage. You can't sit there and look at your spouse and place blame on him, place blame on her, and say, yeah, you know what? If they would just do this, my life would be so much better. Really? Well, you can reverse that. And what do you think they would say about you, right? What would your spouse say about you? So what can you do, since I know you're in it to win it? That is your Kiss to Keep It Simple strategy. Be in it to win it. You got to stay in the game. So you got to be all in. You got to say, yep, I'm in it to win it. We got this. You've got to be driving the boat, not just floating in the water. Because eventually you'll sink otherwise. All right, the waves will come. You'll get sunburned. Something will happen. I mean, maybe I have a little bit too much summer on my mind. But seriously, you have got to be in it to win it. That means you got to be driving the boat. You've got to get up and do something. You've got to be willing to look in the mirror. It starts with you, my friend. And I know none of us want to hear that, because I can hear it already. Oh, Christiane, you just don't know what my husband does and what he says and how he treats me. You just don't understand the way my wife looks at me and the things she says. Everything that you say can be put in reverse, and that spouse of yours can say the same thing about you. So that's why you have to look at your own reflection. What can you do? This is not about pointing fingers. What's that old saying where, you know, you don't point at someone because there's technically, I guess, three fingers pointing back at you, right? So you got more pointing back at you than you are pointing at who you're pointing at. So think about that, right? Be in it to win it. Say, you know what? I want to be driving the boat. I want to have an incredible marriage. I don't want to be that, okay, the kids grow up and all of a sudden now we part ways because we have nothing in common. All hope is lost, and, you know, what we thought we had when we first got married, yeah, it was good, and we did things, but everything was wrapped around the kids, and now that the kids are grown, and, you know, now they're moving out, and they're getting their own lives, well, I don't really know who I'm sleeping with. And now it's like, okay, and you start doing your own thing. Instead of coming together, you begin to drift apart. You're floating in the water, he's driving the boat, or vice versa. But you're not going in the same direction. So if, my friend, you want to be in it to win it, this is what it looks like in real life. Number one, lead by example. When there are situations where one spouse appears less committed, it is crucial to lead by example and demonstrate the qualities you desire in your marriage. And by doing so, it allows you to make a positive impact while still respecting your partner's journey, because you've got to understand this. You cannot control your spouse. It doesn't work. So communicate with compassion. Work on your communication skills. Enhance them by expressing your hopes and concerns and desires with love and empathy. Don't sit there and try to corner your spouse and play this blame game and say, well, if you would only do this, I would feel more like this. You know exactly what I'm talking about. We've all done it. I've done it. Guilty as charged. But this is not about pointing fingers. This is about making a difference. And that's what I want you to see. That's what I want you to hear. And that's what I want you to feel in your heart today. It's not too late. Be in it to win it. So when you lead by example, right, you can also foster your own personal growth and development by becoming the best you can be, right? Be your best selfie. You not only increase your own confidence, but you're going to inspire your spouse to embark on their own journey of self-improvement. They're going to be like, I don't know, but there's something different about my wife. And I'm not sure what it is, but I'm sure liking it. And eventually questions will come up. And you'll be able to share a little bit more and a little bit more and a little bit more. But you have to be the one to take the first step. And I know no one wants to hear that because it's a blame game. It works better that way. It's easier for me. I don't have to do more work. Do you know how much work I have? I get it. I know how much work you have. We all have work. We all can handle different levels of work. So we're all in it to either soar or to sink. Which is it going to be for you? And then you've got to show love and kindness. You're kind to a stranger, but you are mean to your husband. Your tone just cuts, oh man, it's like a knife that just cuts right through cheese. Not even an apple. I mean, you know how hard it is to cut through cheese, right? Man, it's so sharp, it just goes, and it doesn't even get sticky. What we do to our spouses is just downright mean at times. So show that love and compassion and kindness. Even when you face challenges, still demonstrate love, gratitude. Be sweet. Small gestures, acts of service, affectionate moments can reignite a spark and remind your partner of the beauty and potential of your relationship. You've got to look at, well, how can I do this? What is it? And maybe you are just fed up. Maybe you're at your rope's end. I get that. So do a little thing. Let me give you this example. When my husband comes home from work, one of his things that he enjoys when he decompresses is his Pepsi on ice. I know it sounds strange, but he wants his full insulated cup filled with fresh ice and a brand new Pepsi. And then he wants to go and he goes and is kind of to himself for a few minutes. And those few minutes might be 5 minutes. It may be 30 minutes. It could be 45 minutes or an hour. Whatever he needs. There are some days that are more stressful than others. But guess what? I can give him that glass of Pepsi with that fresh ice. That doesn't affect me any. That shows kindness and compassion. It's an extension of my heart. Even though I might be feeling like, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. We've all been there. So lead by example. Number two, seek professional support. A lot of people will not talk about this, but I cannot stress this enough. When faced with seemingly imbalanced level of a commitment between two people, you got to seek professional help. And when you do so, it can be a transformative step. A marriage counselor, a coach, a therapist, all of those types of individuals can provide guidance, tools, and strategies to navigate the challenges you may be facing. So like if you're in the water, you got to know how to get back in the boat, right? That's why you have someone to help you. So if you go out and you're one that says, yep, I'm going to seek out counseling, you could encourage your spouse to do the same thing. But let me tell you this. Going back to the stats, going back to the pastors and the therapists and the counselors, from a male perspective, those husbands are not going to end up in that professional support setting until it's too late. That's just the majority of the facts, and the stats prove it out there. Now, I know, women, it's not something you want to hear. It's not something I ever wanted to hear either. But you see, we serve a God who loves us, and with him, nothing is impossible. So even though you think your marriage cannot be saved, God can still save it. Not you, but God can. But you have to do your part. So you can encourage the idea of counseling, but understand this. If it's your husband, right? Wives, I'm talking to you. If it's your husband's and they are like, yeah, nope, don't want anything to do with it, that's fine. Then you go by yourself. You go and attend those counseling sessions individually. And then at some point, maybe, just maybe, your spouse might come around and say, okay, I'm willing to go with you one time. And in all honesty, I think it's more important that you all go separately first before you ever come together. Each of you have your own junk to work with. You got your own junk in the trunk. And that needs to be dealt with before you can come together. But understand this. Even if your spouse doesn't go to counseling, your marriage still can be saved. There is still hope, my friend. And then finally, what I want you to think about when it comes to seeking professional support, don't just stop at the counselors and the therapists and the coaches. Get your hands on books, other resources, podcasts like you're listening to now that gives you some constructive strategies and tools that you can think about. Now, remember, your situation is unique. So you can't just take all the information that you gather. You could read 20 books. You don't need all that stuff in 20 books. You need one thing at a time. One step at a time leads to miles of greatness. It's the one thing first, and then it's the next thing, and then the next thing, and then the next thing. And you build upon it. That's why it's one step at a time leads to miles of greatness. You're on a journey. You're on a journey of healing, a journey of hope, a journey to build a stronger foundation in your marriage. It can happen. But let me also say this, because when you seek professional help, right, there's resources and all of that. That all costs money. So I want you to be very cautious of your budget. And I say that because finances are usually a problem in marriage. If they're not number one, it's number two. And so if all of a sudden you're like, I got to save this marriage. I got to do this. And you go and you take the credit card and you ring up $3,000 worth of stuff and you're having financial issues, that's probably not going to fare well in your marriage right now. And your spouse is going to be like, well, what do you think you're doing? You're trying to be the hero, then all of a sudden, right, now we got a complex issue. Then that's a whole nother discussion. Something else to take to the therapist and say, this is where I'm at now. So I want to warn you on that because I want to show you the whole picture as much as I can. And I want you to think it through. I don't want you just to jump back out of the boat or jump off the ladder and now you're sinking even more, because you've gotten yourself into more trouble. So you gotta find that very fine line of balance as to what you need to do right now. And so that's why I would encourage you, start with your reflection. There are some churches, believe it or not, that do offer counseling. Some charge, some do not. See what's available. You may have some other things within your own area that offer some free counseling. Start there, Maybe there's a coach you've heard of. Maybe there's a podcast person that you've been listening to. Not that I'm saying anything, but you reach out to them and say, what would you do? What would you suggest here? Now, understand your situation is unique. And ultimately, you are making the decision. You can have tons of suggestions coming to you, tons of strategies and tools, but you are the one responsible for your actions. So do keep all of that in mind. I know that's a lot to take in, but I think it's important that we see the real picture, right? I'm not going to sit here and paint this beautiful portrait that's gorgeous, but if you were to turn it over, everything is black. I don't want that. I don't want doom and gloom for you. I want you to look at things in an honest manner and figure out, where do I need to be? And finally, number three, which I know this will probably surprise you a little bit, but prioritize your self-care. When faced with a challenging marriage dynamic, it's important to prioritize self-care as a means of maintaining your own emotional and mental well-being. Take care of yourself. And when you do so, you will be able to approach your marriage with a calmer mindset and a renewed sense of hope, because you got your wits together. You're not crazy. You know, it's not like your hair is standing on all ends. You don't look like Einstein. Have you seen some of his pictures? Not to pick on Albert Einstein or anything like that, but seriously, when you're under stress, right, your hair is going to go white. It just does. You lose coloring, all of that. And so he just had kind of like wiry hair. And so that's just my picture of someone who's like really stressed out. He was just brilliant. So he was just brilliant. That just, you know, his brain was always on fire. So I think that's why his hair looked like it did. But seriously, we don't want to look like Albert Einstein, all right? You don't want to have that reaction when it comes to who you are when you look in the mirror. So you got to take care of yourself. Have that self-reflection time and self-awareness time. You know, maybe you get up in the morning 15, 20 minutes earlier and spend some time, you know, in the backyard or on your front porch just talking to God. Understand your own needs and your triggers, your boundaries, as well as what you're willing to work through to preserve your marriage. And then I want you to think too, you got to have some movement in your life, because when we're stressed, we tend to go hibernate or go hide out in a corner. And that's the last thing you want to do. So engage in activities that bring joy to you, that just kind of cultivate that peace and just brings that, right? It just lowers your stress levels. Maybe for you, it's exercise or meditation. For me, it was running. That's what I did. I would get up early in the morning. When I would wake up, usually it was between 3:30 and 4 o'clock in the morning, and I would get up. Everybody else was sleeping. I had all my stuff laid out, so I would go out into the living room. I got dressed in the living room, got everything ready. I got in my car, and I drove literally not even two blocks down to the high school track, and I started there every single day, and I did it for a couple hours, sometimes 2.5 hours, depending upon what time I woke up. If I was there at 3:30 in the morning ready, I was there usually for 2.5 or so hours. Sometimes I'd be there for 3 hours. But I was home before anybody else woke up. No one ever knew I was gone. Now, you better believe I was asleep very early. I wasn't going to bed at midnight every night, getting up at 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning. So you got to make sure you're getting sleep too. You got to prioritize that. But I started by walking, and then it was walking and then running, walking and running. And then it was all running. And then I would cool down with a walk. Best time of my life. And it was my time. And it was my time with God. And I got to sort out stuff. So what do you need? Where is that engagement with your activity, actually moving your body? Because it's important. And don't forget this. You got to set healthy boundaries. And the boundaries on what I'm thinking about here is not about the no's. It's about the yeses. You need to establish and communicate healthy boundaries within a relationship. This is going to help protect your emotional well-being, right? And it's going to give you that environment to be open and a sense of mutual respect between the two of you. Now, let me give you this example, because a lot of people come to me and say, well, Christiane, you know, we're in dire straits, and I just, you know, he wants sex and I don't want anything to do with him and I don't know what to do. So if you're looking at this from sexual intimacy, okay, and you're like, I just can't go there. I just can't do it. Then what can you do? Are you willing to hold his hand? Are you willing to, you know, give a kiss? Are you willing to massage his shoulders? Are you willing to give a hug? What is it? What are those yes boundaries? Don't look at the no, because what happens is if you're always focused on the no, you'll never see the opportunity of yes. And that's where we fail. That's where we fail our spouse. That's where we fail our marriage. That's where we fail ourselves. And ultimately, that's where we fail God. And I know that's a strong statement, but it is so important that you look at your boundary as a yes. What can I do? This is not about what your spouse can do. It's what you can do. It's the yes boundaries, because I guarantee you, you have much more no's on your boundaries when you're in a state of distress, when you feel like there's no hope in your marriage and you're like, I just have got to nurture something here because I feel like we're dying. I can't do this anymore. My friend, I don't want you to get to that. And while it may be challenging, remember that all hope is not lost. Many couples have experienced seasons where one partner was less invested initially, only to witness remarkable transformations in the future. So understand this. Change is possible. People can grow and evolve in unpredictable ways, right? God can work a miracle in your marriage. God can work a miracle in you. And when you foster an environment of love and acceptance and support, your spouse may eventually undergo a positive transformation. It's not a definite. I can't guarantee anything. Only God can take care of your spouse, but you can take care of you. And when your spouse sees change in you, guess what? Your spouse's reflection is going to look a lot different when they look in the mirror themselves. And remember, focus on your own growth. Prioritize your personal development, because when you do that, you can create a ripple effect that can inspire change in your spouse. Lead by example, right? If you're driving the boat, who's going to catch the waves? Think about it. And keep the lines of communication open always. Listen more than you speak at times. And don't be so forward as into always complaining. Complaining and blame, it just shuts everybody down. It does. And if you're already stressed and you got stuff going on in your marriage, that's one thing that's going to shut down anything. But when you're honest and vulnerable, that's a catalyst for positive change. That makes an impact. Remember, each marriage is unique and no situation is entirely hopeless. Hope is not lost in a day. Go in peace, be present, be incredible, be you. I love you so very much. I cannot wait to see you on the other side. Blessings, hugs, and lots of love. We'll talk to you real soon. Have a glorious, blessed day. Bye-bye.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.